Welcome back to the big program. We got a good show tonight. Rest Hamlin, Twin Peaks. Do you enjoy Twin Peaks, Paul?
Yes.
Did you watch it when it came out?
I saw that famous dwarf episode.
See, I missed that one.
You missed that one?
I didn't see the dwarf episode.
Unbelievable.
Let me ask you a question, Paul. If you had to identify a new American breed of weasels, they received more Emmy nominations than any other television program. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Russ Hamblin. Yeah, well. Well, congratulations on all the success. This must be quite welcome to you and your friends, huh?
Yeah, it was thrilling today. We got 14 nominations. Yeah,
congratulations. Now, we were looking at a little of this tape this afternoon. You play this Dr. Jacoby guy.
Right.
Now, what as you understand it, since it's your character, I guess you developed most of it.
A lot of it, but not all of it.
As you understand it, what is wrong with this guy?
I didn't think anything was wrong with him. I just thought he was a little eccentric, but certainly not as bizarre as everybody thinks he is. I was completely surprised at the end of the season when everybody thought that I was like a number one suspect.
Right. Now do you know if you murdered Laura, what's her name, or not?
No, I don't know. Nobody knows.
But do you think it would be a good idea to have your character be the person who did it?
I don't think so. It seems to me whoever did it, I mean, can't last very long in the series.
True. All right, so now when we look at you and you have those things hanging out of your ears, what are those?
Yeah, they were earplugs. Uh-huh. I actually wanted to use, I approached David Lynch when I went up there to do it with two big wads of dirty cotton, but he thought that was a little too far out and that I might not have any patience.
Yeah.
So I just used earplugs.
Do we have the clip of what we're talking about here? Is that ready to go? Is that the same scene? All right, let's take a look at this, and then I want you to explain just exactly what the deal is here on Dr. Jacoby. Is that the guy?
That's
him. Okay, roll the old Twin Peaks clip.
Special Agent Dale Cooper.
Hey, Gary Cooper?
Agent Cooper.
FBI.
Right.
Dr. Lawrence Jacoby, Agent Cooper. Laura was the patient of mine. Listen, you're on your way to the morgue now. Do you mind if I join you?
Yes, I do. Why would you want to?
Sort of against procedure, Doctor.
Well, no offense. I thought I could be of some help.
You still could be. At another time.
Oh, I understand completely. No, by the way, Laura's parents, they didn't know that she was seeing me.
Definitely wrong with this guy. And you're playing with the tie there. Why are you playing with the tie?
Well, the original concept of Dr. Jacoby was going to be that David Lynch originally told me, said, I want this guy to be a guy who's having affairs with his patients, which I thought was an incredible idea. I mean, who would have...
I think
well, first, I can't
unethical.
Read about it, and no one's ever played that kind of part, and who has more access to vulnerable women than a psychiatrist? I mean, you could ask him anything.
Yeah, but is that a guy people would fall for? That guy? Oh, man.
No.
How vulnerable would you have to be? Guy's got quirks in his head. So you're playing with the tie there, and it's a little nervous habit?
Yeah, just a little nervous habit.
Yeah.
But then we straightened him out a little bit, and I thought he got pretty straight in the series, but evidently people thought he was still pretty bizarre.
How did you get this particular job? Because I'm not sure that if I were in charge of that show, that your name would have been on any list anywhere.
It wasn't. It wasn't. It wasn't even on Natalie Wood's list, which I'll tell you about later. But I actually went to a... I went to a party at for a birthday party for David Lynch at Dennis Hopper's
house. This is the guy who's responsible for Twin Peaks and Blue Velvet and...
Right, yes. Yeah. He made Blue Velvet. It was a Blue Velvet party, actually, after they'd finished, and it was a birthday party that Dennis Hopper threw for David Lynch, and I went with Dean Stockwell, who I've known for years and years. And we went there, and it was at one point in the party, Dean introduced me to David, and David was looking at a picture of... Well, it was a girl with a bunch of guys around him. He said, and David said, boy, wouldn't you love to be one of these guys? And I said, well, what I'd really love is to work for you sometime. Mm-hmm. And he looked at me and said, next project. And it was 3 years later.
It was that simple.
Yeah, I mean, usually in Hollywood, I mean, you hear that, you know, all the time.
But you a long time ago, you were in big films, like West Side Story and...
Yes.
Other major productions. And then I did not hear of you for quite a while until you came back here with Twin Peaks. So what were you doing in the meantime?
Well, I dropped out for a long time. I moved up to Topanga Canyon along with Dean and...
Now, when you say you dropped out, what does that mean, essentially?
Well, I got into the fine arts as opposed to the performing arts. Uh-huh. In the performing arts, your goal is to try and make the audience's head spin.
Right.
In the fine arts, you try and make your own head spin, and a lot of times people go, what is he doing?
And did you have much luck up there in Topanga Canyon spinning your head?
I had a great time. I mean, it was during that time when everybody was reading books on how to meditate. I was trying to find one that taught you how to stop meditating.
how to break the trance.
Yeah. Well, it's hard to come down off a mountain, I tell you.
What a commercial. Okay, and then we'll be back here with Rest Hamblin. Russ Hamblin is here, and now let's talk about West Side Story.
Sure.
You must have made that when you were a kid, right?
Boy, it sure feels like it.
How old were you when you did that?
Well, we're celebrating our 30th anniversary this year, 30 years ago.
That's a long time ago.
1960.
Was it fun? Did you know at the time this was going to be like a big deal, kind of a classic film?
I knew it was going to be pretty big at that time. I remember that it was huge. It was a great idea.
Did you get along with everybody in the cast?
I got along great with everybody. Yeah. I had no problems with anybody.
So who else was in there? Let's run them through here.
Well, Natalie Wood, of course.
Yeah, right. Now, did you get along well with her? You mentioned her.
I got along fine with her, but she did have...
What? Excuse me. What? Picture of who?
What?
What? Picture? Oh, there we go. Pictures.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Hey.
I can still do that.
Yeah. All right, so it's you, Natalie Wood, Paul Schaefer.
I did the stock company in Canada.
Richard Beamer, who also is in Twin Peaks, in fact.
Oh, he's also in? Now, what does he do in the film?
He plays a character named Benjamin Horn. Mm-hmm. He sort of owns the lodge and head of the town.
Is he goofy as well?
No, he's pretty serious.
Now, when this thing opened, did you go around to all of the premieres at the various places?
I traveled around all over the country when it opened, and also all over Europe. Yeah. Went to Brussels and Paris.
This must have
London.
Been a very heady experience for you.
In fact, in London, I had the craziest thing happen in London. We had it was a Royal Command performance, and the whole royal family was there. And before the movie started, we lined up on stage, and there were a lot of other celebrities there too. Peter Sellers. One who I had worked with before in Tom Thumb and Yul Brynner and a lot of celebrities. So we came out on stage and they do this crazy thing where two guys come out and they blow these big trumpets and go, da-da-da-da, presenting Her Majesty. This is a big, long speech. She's got a really long title.
I think it's part of the valet parking they offer there. Yeah.
And I had actually met her once before. When she came up to me, she said, haven't we met before? And I said, I don't think so. But that's not true. I mean, actually, it's something I thought of later, you know. No, I didn't have the nerve. You actually told not to say anything except just to answer her question.
Right.
But what happened that was really true is that after we were on stage, we were led back up to our seats, which was in the royal box. And I swear, I sat right behind her in a seat, right behind Queen Elizabeth.
Right.
And Peter Sellers was sitting next to me, and the whole time the music was playing, the curtains were getting ready to open, they were just starting to open a little bit, and the lights were starting to go down, and all of a sudden, Peter Sellers leaned forward, and he said, "Lady, would you mind taking your crown off?" I swear. I mean...
And what did she do?
She didn't blink. She didn't budge, because I kept looking, you know, see if she was going to turn around and whack him or something, you know. Hit him over the head with her crown. Yeah,
that's
she
very, very
she
funny.
She didn't move. And later I asked Peter, I said, "How could you say that? You know, we're all told..." And he said, "Oh, I know her." And later
We go way back.
Yeah, he says, later they'll laugh about it back at the palace.
Oh, yeah. She did.
True story.
Enjoys a good ribbing. So now the new fall season begins, about a month.
Yes, it does.
Now, what do you know is going to happen? Are they going to continue the same thing? We're going to try and find out who killed this poor girl?
I guess they're going to find out, but nobody knows. Not even David Lynch's son.
You did it, didn't you?
I didn't do it.
No, I think it's you.
I wouldn't do anything crazy, I'm telling you, David. I'm straight as an arrow.
All right. Nice to see you. Congratulations on everything. And good luck with the Emmys.
Thank you.
Russ Hamblin, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back.